Well, you can tell by the way I use my walk, Suki. I'm a woman's man.
No
No
time
time
to
to
talk.
talk. Suki. It's good to see
Scotty,
you
Scotty,
back.
Scotty, it's been a week. I miss you. How are you?
Suki, how was your time off? Good?
Good. Easter was good. How's your Passover? Did you have fun time with the family?
I was passed over, Suki. I was
You're
passed
so
right
silly.
over.
You're
I've been
so
passed
silly.
over. It was Passover. It was Easter. I was down in Florida. We'll tell you all about it. We got a great show. Philly Kids coming back, Soup. Louie Bello, country singer, songwriter, R&B guys, phenomenal. Gabe Rutledge, comedian extraordinaire, Soup. This is going to be, we're coming back with a bang, baby, with a bang.
And look, and our friends are just piling up. We got Pamela Nuceta, Anita Anderson was the first person. Donna Frusciante saying it's gorgeous out. Vicki Robinson, Anne Engelbrecht saying hello. Jeannie Clay, Anita Anderson. The gang is all here. Should we start the show, Scotty?
Yes, Suki, I feel like everyone felt a little lost without us. Here we are. We're back. We are here. We're ready to roll. You want to do it? Go ahead. Hit me with it.
Three, two, one. Let's do it. The Suki and Scott Show.
This is one of the funnest shows I've ever done.
It's musical. It's magical.
Whoa!
Oh, yeah.
What she said.
This is a sexy show.
Someone's getting some action.
These larger-than-life personalities are on an exciting new journey as they bring you The Suki and Scott Show.
You guys, I nailed it. You're great. You ask great questions. You listen.
The Suki and Scott Show is your one-stop destination for humor.
You just got George's earwax all over your ears, bud.
Entertainment.
Jessie's girl.
Wonderful.
And optimism.
You guys have such amazing energy.
Let's laugh together.
I love him.
The Suki and Scott Show.
Ah, yes, indeed, Suki, all I could tell you is there is no COVID or pandemic down in Delray Beach, Florida. None
So you, I
whatsoever.
am so jealous. I didn't do anything. I stayed at home. I was stayed at home, but I'm glad that you had a great time. You look tan. You look relaxed. It looked like,
Oh.
getting some vitamin D really served you well. Look at you, the gun show.
I gotta tell you, every day I was down on, I'm like, I'm. Are my abs still there? Do I still have abs? It was insane, Sook. We were in Delray. Everything was packed. People in bars, restaurants, the streets, the cars, the traffic.
Did it feel normal? It felt absolutely
It
normal.
felt normal, but it felt insane. It was the abnormal right now. You walk around with your mask on, and you're like, these people are absolutely insane. We were packed in bars and restaurants, and you're like, nobody's wearing masks, and they're on top of each other, and we're like, this, are we in the, we, it's like we're in the bizarro world.
And you were grateful that you had your vaccine, right?
Got my vaccine, still wear the mask to take all the precautions, and but it's just down there, everybody's like, nah, what? COVID, never heard of it. I mean, it's insane. And then the Texas Rangers opening day, 45,000 people. They're the only people, the only stadium that filled the stadium to capacity for opening day in Texas.
Yeah, that was making that. You know what? Can I tell you something? That was making me nervous looking at all those people
My
there.
God, it's like uncomfortable, right?
It's a little uncomfortable, I have to say. But hey, maybe we're the ones that are shell shocked, and we don't really know what the heck we're talking about. And well, I don't know. I don't know.
I don't know, Suk. I feel good. I feel good to be back. I felt like, this is almost, this show is cathartic for us. It's like therapeutic because I almost felt like I wanted to turn it on and just start doing a show. I had nothing to do during the day. I needed to prepare. And I didn't have anything to prepare
You mean you
for
had no
except my
basement
next
to run
meal.
into? Like you had no like shelter to go to like just get away from it all, get away from the kids, your wife and everybody like that?
It was okay. At breakfast, it was what's for lunch, and at lunch, it's what's for dinner. And you're on the beach. It was windy. It was Florida's crazy, Sue, because you drive and it's windy and cold and it's rainy and nasty every 30 feet. The weather changes, and every 5 minutes, it's either sunny and cool, it's warm and breezy, it's drizzling. It's like you never get anything straight until, of course, the Stanfords leave Florida on Sunday, and it's the nicest day of the year, 85 and sunny
The weather
the
was
whole
beautiful.
time.
The weather was beautiful. But listen, I'm glad you got to take a break, of all things. I mean, I'm really waiting for my like 3 weeks away this summer. Like, yeah, I am waiting.
Yeah, you always go away in the summer.
Yeah, I'm waiting. It's been a long winter. You know, the kids are back at school. My daughter goes back to school next week. You know, just trying to get like the whole life in order. You know, we were talking about that, Scotty, getting life together. Let's get back to normal.
Sook, we have an amazing show tonight. Gabriel Rutledge is in the house, comedian extraordinaire. The guy's going to blow you away. He's so funny. I've been watching his stuff all day. Louis Bello. You want to see Louis Bello? Hold on. This guy, country singer, R&B. Let me give you a little taste of Louis Bello. He's coming up a little later on. Take a listen to Louis. This guy's great.
You've got a cold heart and a cold hard truth. Got a bottle of whiskey, but I got no proof that you showed up tonight in that dress just to mess with my head. So much for so long, out of sight, out of mind. Girl, you're looking so good, it's driving me out of mind. Oh, you're breaking my heart, baby, you're playing hard to forget.
Yeah, Louis really Bell good. Coming up later on.
It's hard to look at the Celtics jersey, though. I'm just saying that out loud. Yeah, he's a Knicks fan, you know?
He's from Boston, Sook, but he's a music teacher by day.
And he does country from Boston? Wow.
Country singer at night. So Louis is going to join us. It's funny. I'm reading all the comments coming up on the side. Everybody's so excited to be back with each other. All the viewers, who, you know, hanging out together.
And, I know. They're like saying, look at GD Clay going, Yvonne Burns. Hi, sweetheart. How are you? What's going on? Oh, how's your family? How was Easter?
Everybody.
I love our community that we've created, really. I mean, honestly. They miss each other, and I think they've become really good friends through us and through this show. That's the most beautiful thing to watch.
And folks, I talk to the folks at Stir, which is a broadcasting arm of Sinclair Broadcasting. We're on Stir a couple times a day during the week, and they are so happy with the show, Soup. They say the viewership is grows every day, and they're so happy. And, you know, listen, it's blowing it out. The show has just snowballed and, it's unbelievable. We are booked through to the middle of May. I got to tell you, we're booked through the middle of May. So we can't stop the show even if we wanted to.
Can't stop it. The train's rolling.
So tomorrow night, we're going to have our Sookie and Scott mailbag where we open up the mailbag for you and I to answer some very important questions.
The mailbag kills me every time, I got to tell you.
Before we bring Gabe in just a little bit, I wanted to give you a little, you know, first night back from break, we missed April 1st, which is April Fool's Day.
April Fool's Day.
So in honor of April Fool's Day, I wanted to throw a couple of headlines by you to see if you could pick out whether they're real headlines or fake headlines.
Okay.
All right. So for example, I give you this one. Father uses his Camaro to pull out son's tooth.
I feel like some father out there actually did that.
You're going to go with real headline?
Yeah, maybe the door. He didn't put it at 100 miles per hour and drag the kid.
$1 million on the line, Sook. You are correct. That is a real headline right there.
And look at the license plates. Florida.
Oh, it's got to be. It can only be Florida. It should just say Florida man uses Camaro to pull son's teeth.
Exactly.
Out. All right, let me give you the next one. Here we go. Here's father calls 911 after eating daughter's pot brownies, thinks he's having a stroke.
True.
You're going to say that is true, Sookie, and I'm going to say you are 100% correct. This one.
Because you know what? That's like something any dad will do. Like, oh my God, honey, you cooked a batch of brownies for me. Meanwhile, the daughter's like, Dad, that's for my friends in the sleepover.
Yeah.
You want Dad's getting it. Sauce.
All right. So here's the next one, Sook. Real or fake? Goats in police custody after chasing a group of children. Goats
true.
In police custody after chasing a group of children. You're going to go true. You are correct, Sookie. This one also from Seattle, I think up near where Gabe Rutledge is actually located. Mm. I think he's up in the Northwest somewhere.
It's kind of like when you go on the golf range and the damn geese start attacking you. I don't know if that's ever happened to you, but I believe when animals attack, they will attack. And so goats, geese, all of that all goes in line with each other.
Here's one more, Sook. Here's one. Woman accused of assaulting a man with her breasts outside of a gas station. Woman accused of assaulting a man with her breasts outside a gas station.
Or did she stick his head in there and just go, come on. No, I say false.
She was charged with unwanted brum skiing. That is a real article, Suki. Real article. Woman accused of assaulting man with her breasts outside gas station. Of course, just a little north of Florida, but it's in Athens, Georgia. So that one is real.
I'm very confused. How does she assault him?
I want to know what man calls the police for being assaulted with a pair of breasts. What kind of guy is this?
Mama. Duke,
Gabe Rutledge is coming up. Louis Bello will be here later on. Philly Kid, of course, coming up in just a bit. Still celebrating our year anniversary. We're coming back right after a little fantastic flashback. Gabe Rutledge on the other side.
It's a Suki and Scott Show fantastic flashback.
On November 13th. Look at you. You're both.
Okay, so there was a trivia question. So, you know, there was that voiceover guy, two men.
Yeah.
Or
Yeah.
What was the thing he said? Oscar was.
Suki says on November 13th, Felix Unger was asked to remove himself from his place of residence. That request came from his wife. With nowhere else to go, he returned to the home of his childhood friend, Oscar Madison, who several years earlier was also thrown out of his place. Can two divorced men live together without driving each other crazy?
I love it.
Did you do that voiceover, Scotty?
I was the guy.
He was 10. He was 10 years old.
I was the guy. All right, so you're both 4-for-4.
Here we go.
This is the tiebreaker right here. I have a feeling one of you may or may not get this. Here it is. Listen closely. Suki says Beverly Hills 90210. L.A. Law, ladies and gentlemen, the correct answer is Beverly Hills 90210.
It's a Suki and Scott Show fantastic flashback.
Ah, Suki, you took him by one. You took Dave Knoll by one.
Dave was a great guy.
You thought he would have got 5-for-5, but you beat him, Suki. And that's why we keep you around.
Thanks.
Are you ready for little Gabriel Rutledge?
I am ready for Gabriel Rutledge.
Here we go. I'm going to show you a little bit. We'll bring Gabe in on the other side. Take a look.
You can tell this is a big night, you guys. I'm wearing a shirt with buttons. I'm not messing around. Yeah. This is really, with this hair and beard, this is about as nice as I can dress. I tried to dress up. Doesn't work. I had to wear a suit to a wedding 2 months ago. I was walking down the street in my suit. A guy driving by yelled out his window, "Good luck in court!" And then I saw my reflection. I'm like, oh, he's not wrong. It's either that or fun youth pastor. Those are my choices.
Ah, there he is, ladies and gentlemen. Gabe, how you doing, buddy?
Gabe!
Good, I'm doing good. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, we hear you perfectly, bud. Fantastic. Good use of the microphone.
Yeah, I am. I'm just going to acknowledge real quick. I thought, you know what? I'll set up right in front of my bedroom curtain, and that'll be a nice 70s show business look. This looks like a hostage video. They're treating me very well here.
Yeah, Gabe, just blink. Gabe, you have that curtain just handy in your bedroom?
Well, this is a sliding glass door. If some cats want in later, this show's about to really pop off. Yeah, it could. But yeah, thank you. And I yes.
Scotty, you don't have a blackout curtain where you just shut the whole world out? I mean, come on. I mean, what planet are you on?
Yeah, I guess we kind of do. I guess we have one of those. I was thinking he was in it like a hospital curtain, one of those deals. Like,
yeah, definitely. I think we moved into this house 12 years ago, and immediately we said we're getting a new curtain, and it's still here.
It always works out that way, Gabriel. I've been wanting to do so many things, and it's just still there.
You walk in, you go, that wallpaper's gone. There's no way we're going to do that. And then a year later, you're like, I'm getting used to it.
it's so funny. Gabe, I love it, man. Listen, I was watching your stuff today. The Good Luck in Court, that line, that's actually the title of your album, right?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, it's fun. You know, I started growing my hair long when I was 40. This is my very mild. Well,
this was you.
Yep. There's me. Look at that guy. He has a job. He looks responsible. He's wearing a polo shirt. That guy looks like he plays golf. I look like I mow the course now. But
man, what made you decide to grow your hair like that?
I don't know. I think because I could do it at 40. You know what I mean? But it's I don't know. It's one of those things where it's like I noticed I didn't mean to. I used to jokingly do this when I had short hair, but all of a sudden you notice long-haired guys, when they're done talking, they do this move. They go like, yeah, so. Yeah, you just nailed it.
That's what girls do. Girls go like this, or they flip it. Yeah.
The problem is when a long-haired man says that sentence, it's never a smart sentence. It's never like, so that's when I got my master's. That has never happened. That not once has that happened.
Now, Gabriel, do you put it all into a bun? Like, do you take it and make it into a man bun?
I have worn it in a man bun in public once. It was Wendy. I do not need your judgment.
I'm judging you. I am. I'm judging.
This is 100% true, though. I walked into a Starbucks. I had the man bun in. I was the only one there. The guy behind the counter goes, are you here for the job interview? And I never wore a man bun again.
You were that guy. Can I have a double venti?
That is so funny, man. And you've listen, I know in one of the in one of your stand-up acts, you were kind of where are you? You're in the Northwest, right?
Yeah, goat country, buddy. I live in Olympia, which is a little south of Seattle, Olympia, Washington.
Okay. Beautiful. And I noticed you were doing stand-up where you were kind of like, hey, it's great to see everybody finally coming out, but it was like kind of a half-filled place. But it was one of like you started doing live comedy back on stage again.
Yeah, I never fully stopped because some places were open and some, but it's a lot more fun now than it was over the summer and things like that. But I'm doing. Here's an example. I went to a buffet last month, which I'll be honest, I didn't know if that was coming back. But I was at a casino working and, you know, I got a food voucher. I'm in show business. I'm not here to brag to you guys, but you know what I mean? I'll do okay. And I go to the buffet, but there's COVID restrictions and you're not allowed to load up your own plate. And you don't know shame until you have another grown man fill your buffet plate for you. He's just sort of expectantly looking at you. He's like, is there anything else? I'm like, yeah, quite a bit more, actually. We're going to get into this.
But you know what? I would think that with a mask on, it's way better in the buffet line than anything ever was. I mean,
we should have all done
it. We worked the news before where, you know, you'd go to the hidden camera and you'd find the guys like picking their nose, sneezing into the buffet. I mean,
this is what I realized about the mask. And this is going to sound creepy, but before I wore a mask all the time, I did not realize how much I smiled at children. Because I'm trying to not be a threat. Do you know what I mean? So they walk by. I'm like, hey, I'm a big furry dude. I'll just give you a quick little friendly smile. And now I'm doing it with my eyes, and I think I'm overselling it.
It's so true.
But they just walk by, and I'm like, I don't think that's less threatening in any way for these poor kids. But
oh, it's so funny, man. Now, listen, I saw you on Instagram talking about the safe word being meatloaf and how that was taken from you.
Maybe.
Which is kind of funny. You know, it's your safe word during sex. I would do anything for love, but I won't do that. But it's meatloaf. So did you come up with that joke?
Well, you know, it's interesting because a common thing that happens is memes get taken from stand-up comedians and then they kind of just go everywhere and they don't belong to anyone anymore. And I do think that one was probably taken from me, but I should have known the internet better, because as soon as I claimed it, as soon as I said,
you got ripped.
Oh God, I got killed on TikTok. I'm telling you, those kids are brutal. So, you know, I was like, you know, I'm pretty sure they got this from my joke. And then it's like, oh, people are writing stuff on there. Like, my uncle said that joke in years before meatloaf existed. You know what I mean? So it's like, okay, I'm sorry I claimed anything. It belongs to the universe now. But that is a thing that happens. It's just lines from stand-up comedians they become memes, and, you know, it kind of gets away from you. But
so
oh well. What's it been like for you with three kids, you know, COVID, home life, all of that stuff? Like, how have you been able to manage it? How old are they now?
Well, how have I been able to manage it? I haven't. I'm doing terrible.
Their mother, Christy, takes care of everything, right? Christy takes care of everything.
Well, there is some truth to that. I'll be honest that I am the assistant manager of my family. My wife Christy is the manager. I work as a team. That's what the assistant manager does. Maybe I don't have the same understanding for our policies, but we work as a team.
Where is my husband? Hello, where the hell is he? He needs sometimes, to listen to this.
Sometimes they have to be like, look, kids, I also don't understand why it's so important to replace the toilet paper roll. But
because
this is coming from corporate. My hands are tied. She's good at like the business of running a family, and I'm so not. The only reason I get to be assistant manager is I am sleeping with the manager. which is also why we have three employees, now that I think about it.
That's so funny.
But yeah, when I used to travel all the time, I used to miss my children, and now the last year I've missing my children is the
So is everybody.
They're here. They're here now. Between these walls. They're here. They're here. Yeah. Looking somewhere.
I want to miss you very badly. Give me some time.
Yes. And then part of being a stand-up comic is I miss a lot of events. And so the good news is I was home, but all their stuff was canceled too. So you know what I mean? It's not like, oh, I got to watch all the soccer games or all the, you know, it was still just a crazy. And my son,
you're still going to be missing everything.
Exactly. My son is 18.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Quick. Just to, you know, give your viewers a quick impression of my 18-year-old son. Yeah, we used to have conversations. We used to use words, and we are down. It's like living with a congested goose. Just huh, huh. That's all we get in my house right now.
It's like Bert and Ernie.
He's not even he's still not going to school, but I make him go sit in the parking lot for 6.5 hours a day. Use their Wi-Fi. We're still paying property taxes. Get over there.
It's hysterical.
My daughter still complains about getting up to do 3 hours of schooling online, and you can't get them to brush their teeth or flush the toilet.
Oh, no. You know, I was just thinking about that, Scott. Toothbrushing for children is so down right now. Dentists, yeah, we're going to need you in the next year. We're going to need you.
It's unbelievable. You would think you're asking them to go to the chamber. It's like,
it's been a year of just watching my children get weirder and weirder.
Yeah.
And they started out pretty weird anyway, so we'll see as they reemerge. I mean, my daughter's playing soccer again, and when they looked, she's 9. When they looked at the other kids, I mean, it was like they were terrified of each other.
Yeah, it's like
they're just staring at each other like whoa. But they're, you know, they get used to it. That's my age breakdown: 18-year-old son, 13-year-old daughter, 9-year-old daughter.
Wow.
Not yeah, that's not. family planning at its finest. That's terrible.
Dude, I'm right there with you. Messed up too.
Go ahead, Scott, tell me your story. I got a 20 and an 11, two girls. So I'm right there with you.
Oh, Scott.
I'm right there with you.
I saw a lot of men just like you when I got my vasectomy. Jesus
Christ. I thought I had one too, but it was a bad operation. They let me down.
No, this is a terrible story. You know what's funny though about 18, 13, and 9 is whenever people hear that age breakdown, they're always like, "Well, that's great because your son can babysit." And I'm like, "Ugh." I do leave him in charge technically, but I pull the 13-year-old side, and you know, I'm like, "Look, I'm counting on you."
Watch your brother.
Yeah, sometimes the ducks have to take care of the goose. That's our Rutledge family code.
I love it.
You know, it's funny, Gabe, when I was looking today at your stuff, and I'm thinking, but this guy reminds me of somebody. And I know you online, you said that people tell you you're like the love child of these two guys right here.
Yes. Yep.
Dave Grohl and Tim Curry. And I'm thinking, okay, yeah, that does work. But it wasn't it.
I'm thinking
that does he remind me of like a Sam Kinison type? And I'm like, I looked at Sam and I'm like, that's not it either. And for the life of me, I couldn't remember who it was. And I finally thought of the guy. You ever hear of Tim Folger? He's an actor, I just remember him from the show, The Goldbergs. And he was the uncle. He was the father's brother. And this is him right here.
Okay.
And I brother? Just... That was from Curb Your Enthusiasm. Who's Larry's best friend? What's his name? Jeff Garlin.
Okay. Yeah.
Is the father on the Goldbergs. This guy plays the uncle, Jeff's brother. And I'm like, I thought you guys looked a lot alike in this shot.
I can see that. You know what I never get is like Brad Pitt and Legends of the Fall.
You sure?
No, okay, Brad. Okay, I'm obsessed with Brad Pitt for a lot of reasons. It's not your business, but Brad Pitt is 57, and he looks.
Is he 57?
57, and he looks incredible. He looks incredible, and he said he was an alcoholic for a long time. He has those like ab things. Do you know what I'm talking about? Those like the little lines that are buried behind sandwiches on me. Those little. You don't get to be an alcoholic and have those abs. It's alcoholics are supposed to look like me. I thought I kind of had that.
Brad took it from me. That's so funny. Yeah, well, listen, okay, most alcoholics don't have trainers and chefs at their home to get them back into shape. So you didn't have that working for you.
You ever notice every beautiful celebrity, if they say, "What's your secret?" they're like, "I drink a lot of water." Right. Really?
Yeah.
So the only reason there's unattractive people is because they're not drinking enough water.
Right. Not drinking enough
water. As like, how was your date last night? Little dehydrated. my personality a little parched. You know what I mean?
It's so funny because people are walking around my town with these like 8-gallon jugs of water that says good morning. And then it says at 10 o'clock, you have to drink this much. You're almost there, feeling good. It has all these mantras on a jug of water. You're like, what the hell is this all about?
You're going to read all of those in the bathroom. Also, if you shove a burrito in that same container, then I have a problem.
Listen, do you still have your podcast going on as well?
I have a podcast called The Rutledges. I do with my wife. Sometimes it's just me, sometimes with my wife, but we have a good time doing that too.
Any topic that's completely off limits
on the podcast?
Yeah.
I'll be honest. We usually conclude every podcast after we turn off the microphones by saying, "I can't believe we talked about that."
By the way, go ahead.
Well, it's fun. It's fun to share that with people, but it's more fun when you're thinking about the people you don't know. But when you're, you know, at a soccer game and one of the other dads is like, "I heard your podcast about fill in the blank." And I'm like, this is real now. I don't like this at all.
I didn't think people were listening.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly right.
By the way, you got a great book out. I'd love for people to go get it right here. Happiness. Happiness Isn't Funny. True Stories of a Road Comic. Give me one story. I know when you're on the road, man, it's got to be insane. And just the different towns you're in, and the different comedy clubs. I mean, you've got to meet incredible people.
It's true. And like, the basic idea of the book at the time was, you see a lot of books from people who have made wild success, and then they look back on those early days. Mm-hmm. And the perspective of the book was, I don't know where this is going. this could be my paying dues, or it could be this is the rest of my life. And it was a while ago, and I was kind of right about both. I'm not in the same place, but I definitely am not looking back. I'm still doing shows that I don't necessarily want to. But that's probably the thing that people talk to me about most in the book is the worst show I ever did was God bless these people. It was a convalescent home.
Oh, Jesus.
which was funny. And as soon as I got there, one of the nurses was like, do you do a lot of these? I'm like, no one does. No one does. You know, so no one even knew what was happening. I'm just kind of talking to myself. The nurses right. There was a lady who was laughing hysterically at everything. And I thought, oh, thank you. Goodness, she's here. I need her. And then she just fell dead asleep like 10 minutes in. I went back to myself. There was a guy who left the show, which think about that, by the way. I'm where he lives. And he's like, I'd rather just go back to my room and watch Wheel of Fortune. You know, he was in a Little Rascal scooter and he was in the front. And so he was kind of wedged in. And I didn't even know those were particularly noisy machines, but that particular day, he had to do like a 98-point turn to get out of just like, you know, and I'm just up on stage like, so I'm the assistant manager. Hey, you know, but the funny thing is people are like, wasn't that terrible? And yeah, but I knew it was funny then. Do you know what I mean? I'm like, this isn't because I'm not funny. This is a ridiculous circumstance that no one should be doing. Yeah. And that's kind of what being a comedian is like, because it's like, that was the first time I've done that. I did it again. I did because I had it open and they're like, do you want to come back? And you know, I'm like, it's a Tuesday. I could use $300. Sure.
You know? I love it. Before we let you go, how do we get one of these shirts right here?
I think that's a one of a kind that my wife made me. Yeah.
They made that for you?
Yes. I think that was a Father's Day present, actually.
That is so funny, man. I love it. How could people find this book? Happiness Isn't Funny. True Stories of a Road Comic. Is it all on Amazon?
Yeah, it's on Amazon, or GabrielRutledge.com has links to everything I have. And, you know, I got albums. I got tons of stuff on YouTube to watch and all kinds of stuff to enjoy or ignore.
Yeah, so funny, man. You tell some great stories. You're real good with the hecklers in the crowd, you know, the you know, instantaneous stuff. Good luck in court. The album number one on the iTunes comedy chart at one point.
Yeah, buddy.
So you're rolling, man. Keep doing what you're doing. When things loosen up a little bit, did you ever come, you know, toward the New York area to do shows or no?
Yeah, I've done like Syracuse, I've done, but New York, the only time I was ever in New York City was when I did Comedy Central. I taped a thing for Comedy Central, which was a long time ago. I would like to, but it's we'll see. I feel like as everything's reopening, it's like all the dreams are on the table again. You know what I mean?
Wow, very well said.
Yeah, the Louisville Weekly says you're quick thinking, fast talking, hardworking badass. And I love it, man. Keep it going.
I appreciate that. I have that printed in my bathroom.
I think I'm going to print it and put it in mine.
Gabe, thank you, buddy. Where could people find you? Website? Tell everybody where they can find you.
GabrielRutledge.com. I just messed up my own name. GabrielRutledge.com. But you know, Twitter, TikTok, Instagram, all the things, and all the links to everything on at my website. Thank you so much. You guys are the best. Thank you.
You're a funny dude, man. Thank you so much.
Bye, Gabriel.
Thank you, guys.
Take care, bud. So good, Sue. Listen, you go watch his stuff on YouTube and Facebook. Not even Facebook, YouTube. And I mean, you just put his name in and it's just, I mean, I was watching his stuff today and he was really fun. Kind of reminded me of Sam Kinison, but without the yelling. You know, Sam always, he was just, he's a really funny guy. Sook, listen, I want to remind everybody that we have this charity concert coming up on the 22nd, celebration of James Taylor, Carly Simon, Carole King. The link to get your tickets is pinned to our Facebook page up at the top. Again, it's April 22nd. Mm-hmm. And listen, some people think that you get the tickets and you're actually going to go to a venue to watch the show. This is a digital virtual show. You don't have to go anywhere. You're going to get a link in your email when you buy the tickets. That's like $15. It's a performance, you know, for Carole King, James Taylor, Carly Simon, a tribute to those folks. And the music is fantastic. Listen, we all know the music, right? Every song. And it's going to be great. The a portion of the proceeds benefits the First Responders Children's Fund. It's $15, people. Get your tickets. And we'll have an after party after the show. Yes, Scott, that makes sense. It's after the show. Sook, you and I will kick off the program beforehand. Woo! But it's going to be a fantastic night, man. We just want everybody to be involved. And it's for a good cause. And it's a really good show. And it's great entertainment. You know, we're not asking you to put out money for something you're not going to enjoy. So just do it, man. Go get your tickets. We want to
us. I mean, the whole thing is like, this is sort of a culmination of what we've been trying to do for the last year. And so, you know, we came up with something that would be a celebration of what this show was all about, which is really about giving you a moment to, in the comfort of your own home, relax, mm-hmm. enjoy, be entertained. And this is just an extension of that. So if you love this show, this is a great way to support us because, you know, we give our time for free and we sit here and we book and entertain you and try to create connections for you. So this is just a way of us asking you for this full circle moment to come celebrate the 1 year anniversary of why we started the show and keep the entertainment going.
Yes. And one day we're going to do it in a live venue, Sookie. This is not that day, but one day we will do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
A lot definitely. Of our guests, celebrities and performers, a lot of folks going to show up. You ready for a little treat, Sook?
I'm ready. Let's do it.
All right. It's time for the musical portion of our program, Sukanya. Listen, Louie Bello, country R&B star, recording artist. The guy's, you know, he's just climbing up the ladder, Sook. I played a little bit for you earlier on the show. Louis so standing by. He's got this a new song out called Rescue Me, which a lot of people are talking about. Us Magazine has him in there.
Featuring Jason Tucker, right?
Yeah. He did it with Jason Tucker. Here's a little bit of it, and then we'll bring Louis in on the other side. Take a listen.
Staring at these walls tonight, wrap my head around what's wrong or right, trying to make sense of it all. Yeah, I know that it's 3 a.m. I appreciate you listening. Is it them or could it be my fault? I'm just trying to make sense of it all. Yeah, you rescue me when I'm lost. Yeah, you fight for me, no matter what the cost. I don't know where I'd be, what I'd do without you. Cause you rescue me when I'm lost. You rescue me when I'm lost. When I'm lost. You rescue me.
Love
ladies and gentlemen, Louis.
Hey, Louis. Hey,
how are you?
Louis, good. When you come up, I just want to clarify, when you come up to the plate for your at-bats, they're not booing, they're yelling, Louis, right?
This is true. I was at the, I sang the anthem for the Red Sox game last night. Last night? Yeah, last night. So I heard a couple of loos, and I was like, I hope that was like not a boo, but a loo.
Right. The announcer always has to explain, folks, they're not booing. They're saying loo. So, all right. So wait a second. You sang the anthem. Did the Red Sox win yet this season?
They won the night I sang the anthem last night.
There you go. So what, 1-3 now? 1-3, the Sox?
Yeah, who knows? I don't know. This year's going to be rough, but it's all right.
That's great, man. You'll get you at Fenway Park. Good for you. Yeah,
it was really weird being there because, like, only 4,000 people, so it was kind of like – it was surreal, but it was just glad to see people working again. That's what I was
at. Fenway Park is always sold out. They're always sold out. Crazy, crazy. Well, good to have you on, man. Pleasure to have you tonight.
I really appreciate you guys having me on.
Listen, that song, Rescue Me, it's like music with a purpose, right? I mean, it just kind of tell us about how you came to write that song with Jason.
So I met Jason randomly about 4 years ago. I go down to Nashville like pretty much every month the last like 7 years. And I was on Instagram one day and saw one of Jason's songs being promoted. So I literally just messaged him and was like, hey, not trying to be a weirdo, but liked your song, dude. Like, we should catch up sometime down in Nashville, you know? And he's like, yeah, cool, man. So literally like 3 weeks later, we caught up, grabbed some food, hit the studio, wrote a song, and we've just been friends forever since. And over COVID, over the quarantine, we were writing a lot of songs. And this just happened to be one that that we started on Zoom, and I flew to Nashville to finish the vocals with him.
Wow.
And then we mixed it in Boston. So,
wow.
Yeah.
When you guys record in Nashville, are you like along that studio row where all those studios are in those houses?
Yeah. Sometimes there was a studio around the corner from there called the Brown Owl Studios. It just closed because of COVID, because it just couldn't stay in business. Yeah. But it'd been around for a long time. It was actually Thomas Rhett's drummer owned the studio for years. Wow. So there's all kinds of cats that walked in and out of that studio. But we recorded the vocals for that, half of them there and then half of them in Boston. So
that's great, man. Yeah, Soup, there's a street in Nashville.
Yeah.
They look like houses.
Yeah.
But it's a street of all recording studios. Oh, wow. Right after the next. And they all have different names to them. And it's like, Sheryl Crow recorded here. Right, the Tim McGraw recorded here, and it's wild. It's just a row of recording studios.
If they didn't have signs on it, you would just think it was a neighborhood.
Right, you would think it looks like a neighborhood with houses.
Yeah, I was in a writing session once, Big and Rich, ride a horse, save a horse, ride a cow.
I was
just in this publishing house, and I thought it was like a small one, and I'm writing, and I start looking on the walls, and I'm like, oh crap, really? Like these dudes wrote here. This is awesome.
So Rescue Me is about like thinking about people who are important in our lives, people who have like lent a hand or is that something that you took from being a teacher yourself?
Yeah, you know what it was is so obviously we all rely on our first responders. I mean, that's just, number one. You know, you're in trouble, you need an ambulance, a doctor, a police officer, a firefighter, like that's the stuff that we always talk about. But I don't think we talk enough about first responders that are like in our lives, like immediately right there for like the mental break that we need, or just, they talk you off the ledge. Sometimes it's your brother, your sister, your mother, your father. It could be your best friend. It could be a student, if you're a teacher, or if you're working with people, it could just be the smile that the old lady at the nursing home puts on her face when you're reading her a book and she just changes your whole attitude about the day. Yeah. And that's something that we talked about. Like, people don't really talk about that as much. And with this quarantine and pandemic, I think that those people helped out as much as first responders did in most people's lives that were cooped up in this house watching Netflix for like 24 hours a day. We needed that. Although
that's truth right there. Right.
Although Netflix could be considered something that rescued you too.
Oh, it could be a bit of a therapeutic pill too. Yes, yeah.
I remember when they first came out, Netflix was, they would deliver DVDs to your house, right?
You'd
have to send it back for another one. Unbelievable. Good job, Blockbuster, not buying into that one.
Did you see that? Side note, did you see the last Blockbuster on Earth?
No, I started watching it and I got sidetracked, but I got to get it.
Is it good?
It's just nostalgic because we all rented, we all rented, VHS tapes and DVDs and you know, so it's just really cool to watch it.
Lou, they never had an adult film section at Blockbuster. Souk, anytime you went, when you were a kid, let me tell you, I don't want to get too sidetracked, but when you were a kid, and Lou, tell me if this happened to you.
So I can already say yes.
Blockbuster wouldn't have the adult films. So you'd have to go to like your neighborhood, you know, Joe's, you know, video store.
Yeah.
The adult film boxes, Sue.
Joe's Pornomac?
It was a regular, you know, Village, you know, video rental. But they always had the porno section through the Western swinging doors.
Yeah, the beads.
Right, with either beads or the doors. So they always
a lava lamp.
If somebody went into that section, so like as a kid, if you wanted to sneak in, you know, just to look at the boxes, because they always had the best looking women on the box.
They Scotty.
They weren't even in the movie. But Lou, tell me, so you'd walk through it and it was always a big giant mirror, like one of those parking, you know, pulling out of your driveway mirrors. So the person at the cashier can see, and you'd push the door and it'd be like, you look up, right? You're looking up the mirror and you're like, I didn't know where I was.
Yeah.
You know,
we used to
came in here for the milk. Anybody got milk?
Yeah. I'm not saying I know personally, but I heard from a guy that you could do that back in the day.
It used to do it.
You give him $5 and he'd let you go in for 5 minutes. It was
always so loud. Well, listen, man, Rescue Me getting some great acclaim. Here's Us Magazine, country artist Louis Bello teams up with Jason Tucker. A lot of people talking about it. We played it right before you came on. You want to sing a little bit of it?
Sure. Yeah. I'll sing a little bit.
Go ahead, man. Then we got to talk about, you know, teaching those school kids up in Boston.
Yeah, let's do this. All right.
Staring at these walls tonight, wrap my head around what's wrong or right, trying to make sense of it all. Yeah, I know that it's 3 a.m. I appreciate you listening. Is it them or could it be my fault? I'm just trying to make sense of it all. Yeah, you rescue me when I'm lost. You fight for me, no matter what the cost. I don't know where I'd be or what I'd do without you, cause you rescue me when I'm long, long, lost. Long, long, lost. You rescue me when I'm lost. When I'm long, long, lost. Long, long, lost. You rescue me when I'm lost.
I love that song.
It's beautiful. Thank you so much.
I love the sentiment. Listen, so, you know, so you've written songs for Keeping Up with the Kardashians, ESPN, Bush. I mean, talk to us about all of those other sort of tentacles that you have.
Yeah, so I've been blessed over the years to do a lot of film and TV writing. So, you know, placing songs on TV shows. And it's been a cool experience, because when you have somebody call you up and be like, yo, dude, I was just watching the Kardashians. Don't tell anybody, but I heard your song. Is that your song? And I'm like, yeah, it was, man. What episode's that? And you got to go try to find the episode, and then you go make sure you got paid for it. But it's cool stuff. It's good extra money. And the more you get, the more residuals you get as they play more episodes and rerun. So it's been a good way for myself to make, you know, that extra money over the years to help, you know, push the career.
Fund your passion. Yeah.
Yeah, for like ESPN, anything, you know, that we, you know, is it like Sports Center themes? What kind of stuff?
So the one ESPN, so I have one a bigger ESPN. It was a 30 for 30, and it was called Push. It's called Madison versus Madison. So I actually worked with a friend of mine, Malik Williams, who did a lot of the music supervising on it, and we had written a lot of songs together. So he was doing the music for it, and we submitted a bunch of songs. We got like 2 tracks in the documentary, and then they liked the song Push so much that they changed the name of the documentary to Push.
Wow.
Yeah, because they just thought it was a good, like, it was about pushing harder these kids in the inner city trying to, you know, overcome these challenges to win a state title. And so that was really cool, because to know that your song that you wrote ended up being the title after the fact was kind of very, you know, it was a big honor for me.
Yeah.
The kids that now you teach during the day, you're a music teacher.
Yeah, music and art.
These are kids that are they're not taking music and art because they want to. It's just part of their curriculum.
It's part of the curriculum. Yeah, it's part of the school curriculum.
And do you find that that's harder to reach kids like that? Rather, you know, obviously, if kids come in and they're, hey, I want to take, you know, art and music, when you just have kids coming in, how's the response to, you know, learning about music and art?
It's, you know, it's always a challenge with kids that are kind of like, you know, forced, like you said, forced, like this is your class. But I think visual arts for me, because I went to school for graphic design, so I'm an illustrator by trade. So I spent all that college money so I could be a songwriter. So, you know, that's super proud of me. So, but it is a challenge. It's always a challenge at the beginning, but I think at least for the visual arts part, you can really draw kids in, because I think every kid likes to doodle. So if you can show kids how to doodle and make it look real cool,
yeah,
it's a little easier than trying to show kids how to sing that don't want to sing. So I think the musical end is a little more of a challenge in a general music class. But we do a lot of choruses and stuff after schools where kids can like join up if they want to. And that's a little bit easier to kind of manage. But overall, the kids have a blast, especially during the pandemic. I mean, the kids just wanted to do something other than math and English, you know.
And so, Zoom on that. Yeah.
Yeah. So.
I mean, my kid had to take like home ec, and he was excited to like just learn how to sew. I was like, "Is this for real? Like, you're gonna sew?" I was like, "This is exciting."
That's awesome.
Oh, listen, I saw. What is all this ink over here?
That's my little sleeve. I gotta finish it someday. It's been a couple years since I finished it, but I think I'm gonna go all the way down.
Nice.
Did you draw it?
I drew some of it, like the mic and stuff like that. I didn't tattoo it, but a friend of mine did the
tattoo. Yeah.
Well, you want to sing a little more?
Sure.
The audience was loving you before.
I'll do another song. Let me see here. How about all right, you know what? I got a good one here. You guys will like this. I'll sing a little bit of this song. I've done this, so this song right here for the last 25 years, I've worked it into every single show I've ever done, even at a funeral.
That's a good liner. Even at a funeral.
Keep that. It's a cover. Ready? Here we go. I think you're gonna know this just from the chords. Shorty, get down, good Lord. Baby got it open all over town. Strictly down, she don't play around. Gather much ground, got game by the pound. Getting paid is a forte, each and every day. True player ways, can't get her out of my mind. Yeah, think about the girl all the time, babe. East side to the west side, kicking fat rides. Girl, it's no surprise. Hey, she got stacks in the bag, stacking up the cash. Fast when it comes to the gaze, by no means average. Long as she's gotta have it. Baby, you're a perfect 10. I wanna get in. How can I get down so I can win? I like the way you work it. No diggity. You gotta bag it up, baby. I like the way you work it. No diggity. Da-na-na-na-na-na. So, yes, I did that at a funeral once.
No. How did you work that into a funeral?
It wasn't by choice. It wasn't by choice of that one. That was actually like, they were like, hey, can you do this? And I was like, I don't really want to, but if you want to.
Oh, that was the person who passed away, that was their song?
Yeah, it was like, yeah, because they're from a musical family. But so I've worked that in every show, weddings, cocktail hours, everywhere.
That is fun. I remember as soon as you started singing it, the first thing that came to mind was Pitch Perfect.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
it was
yeah.
In the movie Pitch Perfect, because I've had to watch that 700 times. But
of course.
I don't know if it's 1, 2, or 3, but I remember it was in there.
It's on there. Yeah, it is in there for sure.
It's so funny, man. So listen, you I read that you were also, you know, trying your hand at a little acting. How's that going?
It's going well. I'm actually, so I've been writing screenplays for a few years now, and I formed a production company. Because when you don't have money, I learned when I was about 10 years old, you go out and you get money whatever way you can.
Right.
Not illegally, kids, unless you really have to. But I figured as I was getting up in this music world to start learning more about the production aspect of videos. And so I teamed up with a friend of mine. We started a production company. And so we've been producing all my music videos. I edit the music videos, a lot of them, and we started doing short films. So I was like, I want to act in my short films. So that was my way of like practicing. So now I've been practicing for the last couple of years. I don't know if I'm any good, but we'll, you know, it's a lot of fun.
have you gotten any gigs yet at all or no?
You know, well, I'm going to tell you, you know, the movie, The Heat with Sandra Bullock.
Yeah.
All right. In the club scene, if you watch really slowly and pause it as they're walking through the doors, you can see my big head in the back smiling like this as a dancer. That was my first one.
I thought I saw this guy in that movie.
Right there. Look at that. Old school. That's pre-beard. Pre-beard.
I love it, man.
And I remember those days.
Listen, dude, you want to do one more? Everybody's asking for one more. You got one
more?
Yeah,
sure. Can I do an original?
Absolutely. Sure.
All right, let me do an original. I got a good original for you. Let me see if I can find it. Got it, man. Here we go.
Coming up for you?
Yeah, it's coming here. Let me see. Oh, it's coming up for me. All right, let me try. Hold on. Sorry, technical difficulties.
No, it's okay.
No, do it.
Right. We can edit this part out, Lou.
Yeah, let me say. Why is this doing this? All right, how about bad for you? Let's try this one. Oh, there we go. Ready now? Here we go. And let the beat drop. It's one of my favorite songs. True story, too. Here we go. I'm not a rapper, but I rap a lot. People say I talk too much. I don't think I talk a lot. I just think I'm passionate. I go after it. I see something I like. I'm down for having it. What about you? What you doing here on trivia night with your girlfriends underneath the neon signs? Looking so fine like a bottle of wine. Sun kissed like you grew up in the 619. Well, hey, I paid the DJ to play us a song. You want to come and get your two-step on? Then take my hand and walk this way. And tell me some more about California. Yay. When did you leave? How long can you stay? I hope you enjoying your time with me. I got it bad for you. Cause you make me feel so good. So good, yeah. I got it bad for you. Cause you make me feel so good. So good, yeah. Little snippet of my Got It Bad last year.
Nice.
Thank you.
That song, by the way, 225,000 streams on Spotify. Not bad.
Not bad. That was my best one so far for streams. So I'm hoping for the next one to go a little higher.
It will.
Louis, listen, man, congratulations on all the success. You know, I'm just looking at some of your, you know, album covers and, I mean, it's all good, man. Keep it going and continued success. But, you know, you're doing the song with Jason Tucker, Rescue Me.
I know. You're
well on your way, bud.
I appreciate, you know, you having me on here because it means a lot that people enjoy the music and, you know, and I get to talk because if I keep talking to my wife, she's going to kill me. So at least I get to talk. This is a good outlet for me.
I know how you feel. Where can everybody find
you? Tell your wife I know how she feels.
Everybody can find me. LouisBello.com is the easiest way. I'm a lot. I work a lot on my Instagram. So it's just LouisBello on Instagram. And of course, my TikTok with the youngins. I got my TikTok going. LouisBello. All that fun stuff. So.
You got to see it, Scott on TikTok. He's fantastic.
Oh, dude, it's a full-time job.
I'm about to follow you on TikTok.
Listen, man, you come back anytime. It was a real pleasure, bud.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
All right.
Bye, Louie.
Bye, guys.
Take care, Lou. Oh, such a good guy, huh? Philly Paz in the house.
Luke
could sing his ass off, huh?
Oh, my gosh. That dude is good. He's good. Yeah. And he's a supporter of first responders, law enforcement,
love it.
Veterans. Yeah, I love that guy.
Yeah, no, he's good, man. He's good.
Phil, how have you been? Where have you been? What did you do for a whole week?
Well, you know, without the Suki and Scott show, I've just kind of been wandering around. You know,
the first night I was like this. It was like, oh, I don't have to clean up really fast and get everybody out the door.
I mean, there's really no purpose in life, you know, without the Suki and Scott show. So, yeah, I was kind of lost last week.
Suk, I'm on the beach. I'm like, Phil, send me, let's do a duet. I got to do something. I can't sit around here anymore. We got to do something. Listen, yeah. Suk, before you go, let's talk one more time about the, you know, the Taylor Simon.
Our big concert.
Big concert coming up. Philly Kid, I know you're all pumped up about it. It's going to be great. We've got the after party. Let me pop it up here. I know a lot of people said they've already got their tickets. It's really easy. I think with tax, it's $15, $16. And I think if I understand correctly, the after party is available to the first 100 people. So the concert's available for everyone. The after party, I think, is the first 100 people. So don't wait. You know, get those tickets. And Phil, you know, we were talking about this the other day. It benefits the First Responders Children's Fund. And, you know, there's not many better charities that you could, you know, contribute to. By the way, it's tax deductible, the $15, because part of it's going to a charity.
Right.
And we're going to light that thing up. April 22nd is the date. It's going to be a fun night, fun concert, fun after party, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, I mean, it's way cheaper than the price of going to the movies. I mean, you go to a movie and you got to pay the, you know, to get in, then you buy your popcorn and your soft drink.
Forget that, Phil. How about going to Starbucks and buying a large Starbucks coffee?
Yeah. I mean,
really,
you can't go wrong.
That's $15 right there. Ah, it's so funny. Well, all right, Suk, we will release you from your position.
See you, Suk.
Bye, guys. Take care. Have a good day.
You too.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to the Suki and Scott Show. We're so happy to have you back. Bye.
Another great show tomorrow night. Another great show tomorrow night, Philly Kid.
Yeah.
Let me change up our screen here. We get your dues. We get rid of the other names right there. And look at us. We're rolling. I get rid of the banner. Maybe I'll leave the banner up. Should I leave the banner up? No, let's take that down. Philly Kid, what's cooking, man? How you doing?
I'm doing good, man. Just, you know, the weather here is in the 70s and 80s, and it's a little windy, but, I mean, it's really nice, and I've been able to get out in the yard and do all kinds of things that I've been needing to get done, and you know, having the grandkid over and just having a great life.
Phil, I believe you and I did two duets while we were away. I know we did Kenny Rogers' The Gambler. What was the other one? Two triumphant songs. Was it Billy Joel Still Rock and Roll to Me?
Yeah.
Was it? Was that the one? Were we off for Billy Joel? I can't remember.
I can't remember. I figured you would have them queued up and ready to go.
Well, listen, don't tempt me because I do.
Little Kenny Rogers for you. Come on, Philly Kid. On a warm summer's evening. On a train bound for nowhere, I met up with a gambler. We were both too tired to sleep, so we took turns of staring at the darkness at the window. Till boredom overtook us, and he began to speak. He said, son, I've made a life out of reading people's faces, knowing what the cards were by the way they held their eyes. If you don't mind me saying, I can see you're out of aces. For a taste of your whiskey, I'll give you some advice. So I handed him my bottle, and he drank down my last swallow. Then he bummed a cigarette and asked me for a light. And the night got deathly quiet, and his face lost all expression. Said, if you're gonna play the game, boy, you gotta learn to play it right.
Come on!
You gotta know when to hold 'em, know when to fold 'em, know when to walk away, know where to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. Come on, Philly kid.
Now every gambler knows that the secret to surviving is knowing what to throw away and knowing what to keep. 'Cause every hand's a winner and every hand's a loser, and the best you can hope for is to die in your sleep. And when he finished speaking,
come on,
he turned back to the window, crushed out his cigarette and faded off to sleep. And somewhere in the darkness, the gambler, he broke even. But in his final words, I found an ace that I could keep. You gotta know when to hold 'em,
when to hold 'em,
know when to fold 'em,
when to fold 'em,
know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. You gotta know when to hold 'em,
when to hold 'em,
know when to fold 'em,
when to fold 'em,
know when to walk away, know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. You gotta know when to hold 'em, know when to fold 'em, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the deal is done.
You gotta know when to hold them, Philly kid. Know when to fold them. There'll be time enough for counting, you know, when the dealing's done.
When the dealing's done.
Never have two people done so much with so little. That's what I like to say.
Yeah.
It was the night Chicago died is the one we did while we were away. Yeah. I think. Could have been. We've done a lot of them now. We've done at least 15 songs, I think.
Yeah, I think so. And one we did, and we actually couldn't make it work, so it never aired.
Oh, that's right. Which one was that? Was it Meatloaf?
No, well, that one we didn't.
Oh, no, we never tried Meatloaf. You sent me one, and I was like, I can't, I just couldn't do it. I couldn't keep up with you on it. Or you were in a different tune from like the song I knew, and I was like, oh, I can't do this with Phil. It's killing me. Listen, man, you want to sing a little? We want to put on a little concert of your own here?
Yeah, let's do it. You know, talking about the show that's going to be on the 22nd. How about a little James Taylor?
Nice.
This is probably one that they're going to do on the show. So
you treat him to a little Philly kid. I'm gonna put the banner up because I want people to remember.
Yeah, put it up.
To do this. Go ahead, bud.
When this old world starts getting me down, and people are just too much for me to face, I climb way up to the top of the stairs, and all my cares just drift right into space. On the roof, it's peaceful as can be, and there the world below can't bother me. Well, let me tell you now, when I come home feeling tired and beat, I go up where the air is fresh and sweet. I get away from the hustling crowd and all that rat race noise down in the street. On the roof, the only place I know, where you just have to wish to make it so. Let's go up on the roof. At night, the stars put on a show for free, And darling, you can share it all with me. I keep telling you, right smack dab in the middle of town, I found a paradise that's trouble-proof. And if this world starts getting you down, there's always room enough for two. Oh, let me tell you, up on the roof.
Bam. So you predict that will be a song in the Taylor Simon King tribute?
I think so. You know, I could be wrong, but I may be right. Or I may be a lunatic you're looking for. I may be a lunatic you're looking for.
Well, we should keep it. We should keep it Taylor, Simon, and King for the rest of this overtime.
Well,
which one would you? Give me another James Taylor. I know Baby James is a good song. Please. No, I'm thinking of somebody else. Give me a couple of James Taylor biggies.
Let me see. Shoot.
Oh, Debbie Kalin says the other song was You May Be Right, then The Gambler. I'm way behind with The Night Chicago Died. Right. You may be right. I may be crazy.
Okay. How about...
I still think we should have done Meatloaf.
That's a really hard song to sing.
Before you go any further, do you love me? Will you love me forever? Do you need me? Will you never leave me?
Here's another good James Taylor song. How sweet it is to be loved by you. I needed the shelter of someone's arms, and there you were. I needed someone to understand my ups and downs, and there you were, with sweet love and devotion, deeply touching my emotion. I want to stop and thank you, baby. I just want to stop and thank you, baby. Whoa, baby, how sweet it is to be loved by you. Feels so fine. How sweet it is to be loved by you. I close my eyes at night, wondering where I would be without you in my life. Everything I did was just a bore. Everywhere I went, it seems I'd been there before. But you brighten up for me all of my days with a sweet love so many ways. I want to stop and thank you, baby. I just want to stop and thank you, baby. Take it, Scott.
How sweet it is to be in love by you. It's like sugar, baby.
How sweet it is to be loved by you. I predict that'll be on the show.
Oh, that'll be on the show. How about... He walked into the party like you were walking onto a yacht. Your hat strategically placed below one eye. Your scarf, it was apricot. Take it, Philly.
You had one eye in the mirror as you watched yourself gavotte. And all the girls dreamed that they'd be your partner. They'd be your partner, and you're so vain.
Da, 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 da.
You probably think this song is about you. You're so vain.
You're so vain.
I bet you think this song is about you. Don't you? Don't you? You
well,
have...
Here you went up to Saratoga, where your horse naturally won. What's the line after that, Philly?
Naturally one. Oh, then you flew your Learjet up to Nova Scotia
to see the total eclipse of the sun. And you, what's after
you're
that?
Where you should be
all the time. And when you're not, you're with some underworld spy, or the wife of a close friend. Wife of the close friend, and
you're so vain. You probably think this song is about you. You're so vain.
You're so vain.
You probably think this song is about you. Don't you? Don't you?
Billy Kid, tomorrow night on this very program. Hold on a second. Let me get to it. I got to go all the way down. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
We're into April now, right? Tomorrow night, here's what we have. Another comedian, Key Lewis, is here.
Nice.
Along with Aaron Gage. Remember Aaron Gage, the young kid who played all the parts?
Yeah.
It's phenomenal. He's got a new deal out with different members of an orchestra type of thing. Guy's phenomenal. Remember, and he has his girlfriend who came out. He was singing to her the whole deal. Then on Thursday, we have Wayne Nelson, the lead singer of the Little River Band. Little River Band, Phil. You know, a little group called the Little River Band.
Reminiscing.
And this guy who's so funny as heck, is he goes by the name of Floss the Mac. And he's got videos online that are so funny, man. He's such a funny dude. And Jerry Springer's coming on next week. T.S. Monk is coming on, the son of Thelonious Monk, is it? No, Thelonious Monk, jazz player. His son. Kate Flannery from The Office is coming on next week.
Whoa, nice.
And we got a lot of big stars coming on, and we're booked all the way through May. So
wow,
hey, we'll be here.
Everybody they still want to be on the Suki and Scott Show. It's the place to be.
Yeah. This little frame I'm in with the brick wall and everything behind me, my daughter gets a text today from her friend who's on vacation with her family in Egypt. And she sends my daughter a text with a screenshot of the TV. She says, "Your father is on my TV set in Egypt." Crazy.
So, what show... What show are you on in Egypt?
One of my WWE shows. I'm on in like 30, 39, 40 countries. I don't even know half of them. And every once in a while, people will be on vacation. I'll be like, holy cow, you're in my hotel room on my TV. So it's funny.
You know, wrestling is big over there because there's a lot of wrestlers that are from that part of the world.
Oh, yeah. Wrestling's bigger internationally. WWE's bigger internationally than it is in the States. They're crazy. Over, Australia, the UK, India, all the China, everywhere, man. It's wild. The Middle East. But, yeah, it was funny. Her friend sends her a picture. I'm on vacation in Egypt. Your father's on my TV set. So I'm sure she didn't expect me to pop up. It was pretty funny.
That's great. That just goes to show that Suki and Scott, Scott Stanford and Sukanya.
I'm sitting here in my basement. I'm on an Egypt.
Kirshen, you got it. Just shows how international the show and the
international. It's WrestleMania week. I'm on.
Hey,
the
how about a little Carol King
now? Carol King, which one are you going?
It's Too Late, Baby.
Oh, nice.
Stayed in bed all morning just to pass the time. There's something wrong here, there can be no denying. One of us is changing, or maybe we've just stopped trying. And it's too late, baby, now it's too late. Though we really did try to make it. Something inside has died, and I can't hide, and I just can't fake it. Oh, no, no. You got the next one?
It used to be so easy living here with you. You were light and breezy, and I knew just what to do. Now you look so unhappy and I feel like a fool. But it's too late, baby, now it's too late. Though we really did try to make it. Come on, Philly kid.
Something inside has died and I can't. Oh, I just can't fake it. Oh, no, no. There'll be good times again for you, me, and you. But we just can't stay together, don't you feel it too? Still, I'm glad for what we had and how I once loved you. But it's too late, baby, now it's too late. Though we really did try to make it. Take it, Scott.
Something inside has died and I can't hide and I just can't fake it. Oh, no. Going right into tonight you're mine completely. You give your love so sweetly. Tonight the light of love is in your eyes. Or will you still love me, Philly, tomorrow? Take it.
Is this a lasting treasure or just a moment's pleasure? Can I believe the magic of your sighs? Will you still love me tomorrow? Tonight with words unspoken, you say that I'm the only one. But will my heart be broken when the night meets the morning sun? Take it, Scott.
I'd like to know that your love is a love I can be sure of. So tell me now, and I won't ask again. Will you still love me tomorrow? So that was $15 worth of entertainment right there.
Exactly. So can you imagine?
That was $15 right there. I mean, come on, people.
Yeah. I mean, that's, yeah. If you buy that show, you're not going to be disappointed. I promise you.
No.
I mean, you may even hear this one.
Go ahead.
I feel the earth. Move under my feet. I feel the sky tumbling down. I feel my heart start to tremble in whenever you're around. Oh, baby, when I see your face, mellow as the month of May. Take it, Scott.
Oh, darling, I can't stand it. When you look at me that way, I feel the earth move under my feet. I feel the sky come tumbling down. I feel my heart start a trembling whenever you're around. Do 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 do.
Oh, darling, when you're near me and you tenderly call my name, I know that my emotions are something I just can't tame. I just got to have you, baby. I feel the earth move under my feet. I feel the sky tumbling down, a tumbling down, a tumbling down, a tumbling. Take it, Scott.
Tumbling down. Do, 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 do.
Yeah, it's going to be an awesome, awesome show.
You should be on stage with those guys, I think.
Oh, I would love to.
The orchestra and the singers. It would be great.
Yeah.
That would be really cool.
But remember, the link to where you can buy your tickets, it's pinned to the top of my page if you want to go there, or the Suki and Scott page, Suki and Scott show page. Go click on the link, buy your tickets,
just go buy the tickets. They're $15, man. $15. Like Suki said, that's two double decaf lattes at Starbucks.
Yeah, easy.
Philly Kid, your wife's got a birthday coming up. Is that what I understand?
Yeah, my wife's birthday is on Thursday, and we got it's a surprise, so I'm not going to say it on the show. She might watch, but I'm not going to be here on Thursday because I've got quite the shindig planned for her.
Ah, all right. Shh. Nobody say anything. Nobody say anything. Let's do one more, man. Let's finish us up.
Next Teardrop Falls, Freddie Fender.
You do that one. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, if he brings you happiness, then I wish you all the best. It's your happiness that matters most of all. But if he ever breaks your heart, if the teardrops ever start, I'll be there before the next teardrop falls. Escúchame. Si te quiere de verdad y te da felicidad, te deseo lo más bueno para los dos. Pero si te hace llorar, a mí me puedes hablar. Y estaré contigo cuando triste estás. I'll be there anytime you need me, by your side, to drive away every teardrop, oh baby, that you cried. And if he ever leaves you blue, just remember I love you. And I'll be there before the next teardrop falls.
I love when you dip into Spanish and dip back out.
gracias por las palabras.
Sí. Listen, before we go, we'll hit you with it one more time. There you go. Taylor, Simon, and King celebrations coming up April 22nd, people. If you love us, you will buy tickets, $15. James Taylor, Carly Simon, Carole King. You know the songs. You'll be singing along. It's so easy. You're going to get a little, like a Zoom link right into your email like 2 or 3 days before. And bingo, you're in the show. It's going to be a great night. The portion of the proceeds go to the First Responders Children's Fund. You can't beat that cause. You can't beat the entertainment. Philly will be there for the after party. It's going to be great. So just love it if everybody would tell your friends about it, put it on your own pages, share our page to your page, and so on and so forth.
Yes, it's going to be great. It's going to be a great show. It benefits the children of first responders, and can't go wrong. $15.
Take us home, Philly Kid. Good night, sweetheart.
Whoa, good night, sweetheart. Well, it's time to go.
Do, 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 do.
Good night, sweetheart. Well, it's time to go.
Do, 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 do.
We hate to leave you, but we really must say, oh,
must say.
Good night, sweetheart. Good night.